Good morning, Corinthians. So glad you're tuning in today. Want to remind you that this is Memorial Day weekend. This will not be our traditional Memorial Day service, but it is my hope and my prayer that you will take time to remember those that have paid the ultimate price and given their life for the freedoms that we have in our nation. We have so much to be thankful for, and so many of the great generation that served in World War II are now going on to be with the Lord. But everyone who has served our nation and paid that ultimate price, give thanks to God for them and pray for their families as well. Today, if you have your Bibles, if you'll turn with me to 1 Kings chapter 19. 1 Kings chapter 19, we're going to be reading, beginning in verse number 1. The message actually covers most of this chapter, but I'm just going to read the first four verses. And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and with all how he had slain all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger unto Elijah, saying, "So let the gods do to me, and more also, if I may not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time." And when he saw that, he arose and he went for his life and came to Beersheba, which belongeth to Judah, and left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a juniper tree. And he requested for himself that he might die and said, "It is enough now, O Lord, take away my life, for I am not better than my father's." Over the last several weeks, we've been in a series of messages entitled, "Because He Lives." We've talked about, first of all, "Because He Lives, I Can Face Tomorrow." And then last week, we looked at, "Because He Lives, He Holds the Future." Today, we're going to talk about, "Because He Lives, Life is Worth the Living." And that will be the title for our message today. Life is worth the living just because He lives. We hear that in that beautiful song that we sing, because He Lives. But here was a man, Elijah, who had came to a point in his life where he felt like life was not worth the living. And as we look at his life and see what got him to this point, we need to be reminded about some things that had just happened. If you'll recall, Elijah had just came off a great spiritual high. He had conquered all the prophets of Baal. Matter of fact, he challenged the prophets of Baal, and he challenged them to pray to their God, and he would pray to his God for fire to come down from heaven and consume the altar. And we know how that story went. And here he did. He prayed and he prayed. He let the prophets of Baal pray. He did all those things, and he had water poured on the altar and all that. Then he prayed, and God sent fire down to consume the altar, and it was a great spiritual high. And what we find, it was the people at this point, when they saw that, they said, "The Lord, He is God." They came to the altar. There was a great national revival. It was an amazing experience. But then after that, Ahab goes back and tells Jezebel what happens after Elijah then takes and he kills all the prophets of Baal. Jezebel said, "I'm going to kill you," and sent a messenger to him. And she said, "I'm going to kill you before tomorrow. This time you will be dead. You can count on it." And basically that's what happens. And after this spiritual high, we find that Elijah starts to run. And he just takes off. He starts running. He leaves his servant at one place. And he continues to run on. And he came to a point where he came to this juniper tree. And he just crawled under the juniper tree. Now, a juniper tree does not grow very high. The limbs are low. low. So he was in a low place physically, but he was also in a low place spiritually, mentally, and emotionally. He came to a place of great depression in his life where he had gotten under this tree and he was scared for his life. And he felt like that life was not worth the living anymore. He felt like, just Lord, just take my life. Just end my life. I don't want to live anymore. I have failed you. There's so many things that are not going right in my life. Now, a lot of times people say, well, when you become a Christian, you'll never be depressed or you'll never experience despair. But the truth of the matter is you're going to experience discouragement, depression, despair, all these things we can still experience. And that's what took place in Elijah's life. James wrote in James chapter 5, verse number 17, he said, Elijah was a man of like passions, just like we are. So yes, Elijah, the very one who prayed to God for fire to come down from heaven and consume the altar, that very one that experienced this spiritual high, this very one that single-handedly challenged 450 of Baal's prophets and then slew them, he is the very one that now finds him point at despair. And you can study throughout history, and you can see people who are successful, people who allow their failures to put them in a place of depression. Or sometimes they can be successful and they still would deal with depression. If you, you probably know these names, Leanne Rimes, Johnny Depp, Kim Basinger, Adele, Princess Diana, Winston Churchill, all have shared how that they have dealt with depression before. And then you go back and just look and study the presidents, and you'll find that at least seven presidents admitted to dealing with depression under their presidency. John Adams, Thomas Jefferson, James Madison, John Quincy Adams, and Franklin Pierce, Abraham Lincoln, and Calvin Coolidge. All of these individuals experienced depression and despair. They got to points in their life where they just didn't feel that life was worth the living anymore. You say, well, Brother Jay, what about Christians? Well, we find in the Bible, many of them dealt with depression. And you study modern day preachers. Charles Stanley is one who's admitted through testimony that he has had tremendous despair and depression in his life. One of the great preachers of days past, Charles Spurgeon, he would get so depressed sometimes that he would lock himself in his room and refuse to come out. And he's known as one of the greatest preachers that ever walked the face of the earth. So this problem is a real problem. But what causes this problem? It is a illness of the soul. You see, the Bible tells us that God created us. He gave us a body. He gave us a spirit, and he also gave us a soul. That soul is our psyche. That's where we get the word psych from. The original language means psyche, but that soul is where our emotions is at. That soul is where our mental part. And my friends, when there's an illness that comes to that soul, we can get so discouraged that it can cause depression in our life. And we will get to a point, just as Elijah did, the great Elijah, a mighty man of God, got to a point where he felt that life was not worth the living. And so we have to be careful of that. When we look at that, when you realize and you understand that your thoughts control your emotions, so therefore, to control our emotions, we have to control our thoughts. That is vital for each and every one of us, because it is in our thought process that can lead us to a place of depression. And Elijah had come to that point where he wasn't thinking clearly. He wasn't thinking biblically or spiritually. He had gotten to a point where he was focusing on what he thought the circumstances were. And so, because if we will understand that Elijah could experience depression, then it will help us and prevent us, hopefully, from experiencing it ourselves. If we can see what caused him to have depression, we can also know that it's possible we can get there. We're no better than Elijah. I've not met anybody on this earth that could pray like Elijah. Man, this guy was a powerful man of God, and yet he went to a place where he crawled under a Jupiter tree, where he was ready to die, and he just asked the Lord to take him. He was very, very, very low, and he made four mistakes that he reveals in what he says to the Lord in his prayer that tells us what led to his depression. And I think by understanding the mistakes he made and seeing his depression, it can help us also, because I'm afraid that there are people right now in our society today that some people are doing very well, even with the pandemic, but others, they don't know what they're going to do tomorrow. There are people by the millions losing their jobs. And my friends, it seems to be getting worse. So I know that there are people dealing with depression. I know that there are those that are lonely. They feel all alone because you can't get out and do the normal things that you normally have been doing. So let's look at these four things that we see. First of all, we see that he focused on his feelings more than he did the facts. He said, God, I'm fed up. I'm trying to be your servant. I'm trying to do what you have asked me to do. But the whole nation, Lord, has turned against you. Now, this was his feelings. And then he said, and besides that, Jezebel's going to kill me. She's out to kill me, and I'm just a total flop. I have failed. Elijah felt like a failure, and so then he became to the point where he thought he was a failure. My friends, because you feel like a failure does not mean that you're a failure. And so he said, I'm no better than my fathers, those that have gone before me. I'm no better than my ancestors. I'm no better than the worst prophet that you've ever had. I'm just in a bad place. So he started focusing on his feelings rather than the facts. And you know, that's what happens to us sometimes. We start focusing on feelings and we allow our feelings to control us, to lead us and guide us. And if we feel hopeless, then we feel there's no hope. If we feel like our boat is sinking, then we feel like we're going to drown. My friends, we feel like we cannot overcome the circumstances of life. We begin to focus on feelings rather than facts. And that's exactly where he was at. And he said it in his prayer. He said, everybody's against you, Lord. But the facts were different than what his feelings were. The feelings were one thing, but the facts were totally different. Elijah didn't think about all the people that just a few days before had come to the altar and they said, the Lord is God. He didn't think about all that. He didn't think about that. He thought about one woman who was out to kill him. And yet he says, everybody is against me and everybody's against you, God. He just focused on his feelings rather than the facts. The facts was the only one after him was Jezebel. She was the only one that was trying to kill him. There were so many that were truly falling down to God and worshiping God, and he forgot about the revival. My friends, anytime you experience a spiritual high, you can count on it. Satan's going to come and he's going to attack. I recall when I read the Bible and I read about the baptism of Jesus. Jesus walks up and sees John the Baptist baptizing, and John says, behold the Lamb of God that taketh the sins of the world. And we know the story how he goes in and John baptizes Jesus, and after that the heavens open up, the dove comes down, the dove appears, and there's a voice from heaven that said, this is my son whom I'm well pleased. But right after that, the Bible says Jesus was led unto the mount to be tempted by Satan. Let me tell you, after the dove comes, here comes the devil. Anytime you have a spiritual high, you can count on it. The devil's going to come and he's going to attack. And Jesus was tempted three times right after this wonderful thing, right after God had opened up heaven, right after the voice of God himself was heard. Here we find the Father affirmed, this is my son. And then right onto the scene comes Satan. And it happens in our life today. Here's Elijah who just come off a spiritual high. There were thousands of people that said the Lord is God. There was a national revival taking place. And he said nobody even believed. He forgot all that. He focused on one thing. He focused on his feelings instead of the facts. And it happens to us each and every time that we get depressed. You go back and look. We get to looking at feelings instead of looking at the facts. We're all going to blow it from time to time. We're all going to have our shortcomings. The Bible is clear that all of us sin and come short of the glory of God. But the thing is, we need to know that it is our God who picks us up. The Bible says it is our nature to stray, but it is His nature to restore our soul. So when we stray or when we fall, it's the nature of God to come pick us up and restore us back on a path of righteousness for His name's sake. And so Elijah was at a place where he was just focusing on his feelings rather than the facts. But secondly, he started comparing himself to others. He said, I'm no better than my ancestors. I'm no better than the prophets, the other prophets. Elijah knew the story of Moses and how Moses led the people, and he was supposed to take the people to the promised land, but yet he did not get to go to the promised land himself. He recognized that. He recognized the stories of how people had failed, and so he started comparing himself to other people. He said, I'm no better than anyone else. He said, listen, I'm a failure. I'm doing everything wrong. And so, but God doesn't expect us to compare ourselves to someone else. I'm not Charles Stanley. I'm nowhere near, I'm the least of all preachers, but I'll tell you this, God expects Jay to be Jay. He doesn't expect me to be Adrian Rogers. I'm so thankful for an Adrian Rogers and a Henry Blackaby. I'm so thankful for preachers that have gone before me here in this pulpit here, but I'm Jay Westbrooks, and God calls us to be us. We should not compare ourselves to others. If we start comparing ourselves to others, what we always do is we look at our weaknesses and we look at their strong points. And the promise of God is that He gives us all strong points and He gives us all gifts. And we don't, when we get to a place of despair and depression, we don't look at the things, the strong points that the Lord has given us. We just look at our weaknesses and look at someone else's strong points. Well, I'll tell you, you can draw a circle around yourself, and within that circle, there are strong points and there are weaknesses in every single one of us. So we need to focus on what God has given us, the good things that He's given us, and quit comparing ourselves, our weaknesses, to someone else's strong point. My friends, it's hard to motivate yourself. And the most motivation that we're going to get in most cases to get us going and keep us going is from ourselves. We have to motivate ourselves and let the Spirit of God lead us, guide us, and direct us. But if we motivate ourselves with criticism, we're not going to get very far. So we need to quit comparing ourselves to others. We need to not focus on feelings, but focus on facts. But not only that, we find that he blamed himself for the negative events that were taking place. He said it was all his fault. In verse number 10, he basically says, look, I've been very jealous. I've been preaching. I've been ministering. I've been out here doing what you want me to do. But they have come and they've broken down the altars. The altars of God are broken down all over the nation. People have turned to idols. They're not listening to the message. And so we find that he starts blaming himself for people's responses. Here's the thing. If you witness to someone, if you minister, it is our responsibility as children of God to minister. It is our responsibility to evangelize. It is our responsibility to witness. But it's not our responsibility for the results. See, every person God gives free will, and that person can make decisions for themselves. And just because people do not make the decisions that they need to make or they should make, that does not make us a failure. We don't need to blame the results of everything that happens on ourselves. Now listen, we can cause problems. There's no doubt about that. But my friends, when we are doing what's right and we share the message and we share our, live our life in such a way that is pleasing to God, to set an example for others, and if people do not respond to that and accept Christ, that's not our fault. But he felt like everything was his fault. And so Elijah was depressed because he blamed himself by what others had done or were not doing. And he took that responsibility. And we don't need to do that. And not only that, we find that he came to a place where he exaggerated the negative. He made the negative much more than it truly was. I think we do that a lot of times. I think if you look around, you'll start exaggerating the negative. There was one person, Jezebel, that was out to kill him. And he made it like everyone was out against him. Everybody was against him. But there was only one There was one person that was who wanted to kill him. So he runs 75 miles. He gets under a Jupiter tree, and he has a pity party, a one-man pity party. And the truth of the matter is, when we talk about facts versus feelings, the Bible reveals to him there were 7,000 preachers that had not bowed to the prophet Baal. They had not bowed a knee to Baal. There were 7,000 preachers. He wasn't the only one out there, but he thought he was the only one serving God. And nobody else were, but yet there were 7,000 out there sharing the word, but he kept exaggerating the negative. And I'll tell you, my friends, today, a lot of times we find ourselves in a place of despair, in a place of depression, in a place of just being down in the dumps, simply because we exaggerate the negative. Don't let one man, don't let one woman bring you down. My friend, there are others out there that are standing by you. There are others out there that will lift you up and are praying for you. There are others out there that care. And listen, we cannot exaggerate the negative. The negative is the negative. We can't help that. But there was one person who wanted him dead, and that was Jezebel. Now, let me tell you something. If he would have just thought back to what God had done and how he had slain all those prophets of Baal, my friends, the power of God was on his side. He had no reason to fear Jezebel. But there's a cure for this depression. Those are the reasons for depression, but there is a cure. And we find it as he goes and he finds himself after traveling 75 miles, running, making his way, getting under this Jupiter tree, goes to sleep. The Bible tells us the angel of the Lord showed up and said this, "Get up and eat." The cure is we need to get up and eat. We talked about this some not long ago, how we need to minister. We need to feed on the Word of God. We need to feed on the Word of God. He's saying, first of all, you need to take care of your body. Not only your physical body, but your spiritual body. You see, this body is for our spirit as well. And so we need to take care of that. We need to take care of ourselves physically that we can minister for the Lord, but we also need to take care of ourselves spiritually. And so he was woken up by the angel, and there was a little cake there. And there was also some water there. And he took that and he drank that. And the angel of the Lord came a second time and touched him. And he said, "Listen, get up, for the journey is too much for you." So he got up and he drank. And this strengthened him by that food. And he traveled 40 days and 40 nights. And he went to another place where he found a cave that he laid down in. He went to that cave he spent the night at. And so we find that what we need, what helps us in times of depression is, my friends, we have to, first of all, take care of our body. Take care of our physical body, but take care of ourselves spiritually as well by taking in the food, the Word of God. But not only that, he talked about, secondly, getting some rest. Feed your body and rest. That rest was good. You need a good night's sleep. You've been traveling a long time. You need that rest. And I mean, we've talked about this recently on Wednesday nights, how we need to rest in the Word of God. We need to meditate upon the Word of God. So we look at that. So what we do to deal with depression, the first thing is think about our body and recognize that we need to take care of it physically. We need to take care of it spiritually. How do we do that? By feeding it and by rest. Many times, if we would slow down and just stop, be still, the Bible says, be still and know that I'm God, you'll find that a lot of our fears, our feelings, will be replaced with the facts, and we'll see how things are. Secondly, we need to just tell our frustrations to God. In verses 9 and 10, that's exactly what Elijah did. He said, listen, he had fear. He said, I'm afraid that Jezebel is going to kill me. He had resentment. He said, I'm fed up, and I just can't take it anymore. He had guilt. He says, I'm not better than my ancestors. He had anger. He had worked. He felt like he had worked for nothing, and everything that he was doing, the people were turning against God even more. He felt loneliness. He said, I'm the only one, Lord, that's serving you, even though there were 7,000 preachers who had not bowed down to Baal. He had worry and he had anxiety. He said, they're going to kill me. They're after me. They're going to kill me just like they've killed all the other true prophets. He had all these things in his life. And folks, if you have these emotions going on in your life, they're going to lead to depression, and they're going to feed depression. And if you're eaten up with fear and resentment and guilt and anger, and you're going to isolate yourself, and you're going to think no one cares for you, but I'll tell you, God does care. God knows exactly who you are. You are somebody, and God cares about you, and you are you, and God created you to be you. He wants you to be the best you that you can possibly be, and that means that you're to follow the leadership of the Holy Spirit and let the Spirit of God lead, guide, and direct you in everything that you say and everything that you do. Let God give you a new purpose. And that's what happened. God came to him when he was in this cave and gave him a new purpose. He told him where to go. He told him, I want you to go on who you're going to anoint as king. And he gave him a purpose. My friends, what we need to do is we need to slow down and take care of ourselves. If you're in a place of depression, if you're in a place where you're down and out, where you feel despair, and you don't know what you're going to do, you probably are going to find that you have come to a place in your life where you are focusing on feelings rather than fact. You're probably in a place where you're comparing yourself to others and you're blaming yourself for all the negative that's taken place. And you're also exaggerating the negative in your life. But the cure for depression, the cure for despair is simply this. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. And all I need to do is slow down, be still, know that he's God. Take care of my body physically. Take care of my body spiritually. Take in the word of God and get some rest. Take some rest and take time to meditate and think on the things and the Word of God. Allow the Word of God to come into your life. I don't know where you're at in your life. I have no idea what's going on mentally, emotionally, spiritually, financially in your life. But I know one who cares. My friends, I'll tell you, I care. But more than me, God cares. And God created you to be you. And he's going to use this time to build you, make you, mold you into something that he can use. You're not going to have to. You don't need to compare yourself to anybody other than Jesus Christ. That's the only one that we're to become like. It is the will of God for us to be conformed to the image of Christ. But my friends, God created you to be you. And quit looking at all your weaknesses and all the negative things in your life and recognize that there are strong points about your life and get up and say, the Lord has blessed me. The Lord has given me strength. And I'm going to use these strengths to give him glory, honor, and praise. I'm going to use these strengths to reach people for the kingdom of God. I'm going to use these strengths and let him develop them. Let him take away your fear, your anger, your resentment. Let him take away the depression and the despair, and get back focused on doing the things that God would have you to do. And that's what Elijah did. Elijah got back focused. He received a new purpose from God, a new direction from God. Now you may be in a place in life right now where you're on fire for God and everything's going great. That is wonderful. I'm so thankful. You keep doing what you need to do. Don't ever exaggerate the negative. Don't ever start focus on feelings rather than facts. Can we be honest in closing? Sometimes we let our feelings control us more than the facts do. Have you ever found yourself comparing yourself to someone else? April wasn't feeling this well this morning, but she was going to come. She was going to sing Because He Lives. I thought about trying to sing it myself, and I compared myself to her, and I didn't sing it. You know what I'm saying? Because I know that she would do a much better job than I would. And I started thinking about that. It's very easy for us to compare ourselves to others. I'm not going to be an Adrian Rogers. What a man of God that was. I'm not going to be a Billy Guest or Lindsay Richmond or a Dean Stewart. I'm just going to be Jay Westbrooks. But guess what? That's what God called me to be. And you draw a circle around yourself and you put your name there. That's who God called you to be. God called you to be you. I look out and I see these pictures all around here. God called you to be you. Every one of you. God loves you. Don't get to a place where you let feelings control you. Look at the facts. Fact number one, God loves you. Don't compare yourself to others. Don't blame yourself for all the negative that's taking place around you. Take responsibility when you make mistakes and something is your fault. But we're not responsible for what other people do and the decisions they make. Now, sometimes as a parent, as a pastor, as a teacher, we have responsibilities to try to lead, but we're not responsible for whether or not they're going to accept what God is trying to tell them in their actions. And don't exaggerate the negative, but look to the cure, and the cure is always God. And God will help you. May God bless you. Father, Lord, thank you so much for the privilege and honor to share your word. I pray, Father, that your word would go out and it would not go out and be void, but that you would use it in a way to let us see that even in times of difficulty, in times of hurting, Lord, that you're still there. And it didn't matter how far Elijah ran, your spirit was right there with him. And you sent him a message. And Father, there's somebody right now that's listening today that has run as far as they know to run, and you're still reaching them right now. So let them know that the cure is always in you. They need to eat. They need to take in the Word of God. They need to rest, meditate upon the Word of God. And Lord, they need to share their frustrations with you because you're the only one that truly has the answer. We thank you for those that chose to listen today. I pray a special blessing upon their life. Thank you again for the men and women who have sacrificed, Lord, as we go through this Memorial Day weekend. Help us to remember all the sacrifices that has been made for each and every one of us to have the freedom to worship this morning. We ask in Jesus' name, amen.